So, good evening, everyone. So, if I'm audible, loud and clear, just give me a thumbs up. Okay, so those who are new, welcome to an Academy YouTube channel. I am Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, the dermatology mentor on an Academy. So, little introduction. I am a practicing dermatologist in Jaipur and currently working as an assistant professor. I myself got All India rank 261. So, I am here to discuss all the tips and tricks which I have used for my exam. So hello Vaishnavi, hello Shubham, good evening. So what are we gonna discuss? So today we'll discuss one more topic in my session, that is quarantine. So we have already covered with the two sessions. Now coming to the next session, that is the 10 must know intradermal test in dermatology. We have already done with 10 important appearances, 10 important bedside tests, and now we are doing the 10 most important intradermal test. So this quarantine session is specially made for this time, because you know that nowadays, because of corona, most of you know people are getting quarantined. So the quarantine session is based on that. Okay, so now starting, those who have already subscribed to an academy can access all the courses, but those who have not subscribed to an academy, I want you to please subscribe. We have many good courses over here, crash courses, the test series, which will be very beneficial for you in your upcoming exams. So those who are not subscribed can use my referral code, that is CHESTA10, CHESTA10, to get an additional 10% discount. And those who want to connect with me, here is my Telegram group link. So here we discuss one or two topics daily. You can ask me any doubts, you can ask me any question, and you, if you want any topic discussion also, here you can ask me. So this is my Telegram link. I want you to please get connected with me. Another important notice I want to make is, on Unacademy, we are going with a very important series, that is Crash Course in Dermatology. The crash course in dermatology includes all the high yield topics for AIIMS 2020, or say for any exam, the high yield topics of dermatology. Here the course have already started on 16th May and it will go up to the 4th June. We have one class daily at 7:30 PM. We have already done with skin malignancy, infectious disease. We have done with leprosy and the papillosquamous disease. Today we have a class on basics, and from tomorrow we'll start the sexually transmitted disease. So I request you, those who are subscribed, please enroll into my course, and those who have not subscribed, please subscribe to an academy and use my referral code, that is CHESTA10, CHESTA10. So I think we should start. So hello Sunny, we'll start with our class. Now the class is 10 important intradermal tests. Now what is intradermal test? Now intradermal test, these are the widely used test which supports the diagnosis of whether the dermatological or non-dermatological disease. So it is important or useful for both the dermatological as well as non-dermatological diseases. Now they are mainly indicated for, the detection of immune or hypersensitivity reaction towards the exogenous or endogenous antigens. Now there are two type of hypersensitivity reaction present against these exogens or endogens. These are first immediate, which is called as type 1 hypersensitivity reaction, and the another one is delayed, which is called as type 4 hypersensitivity reaction. Now what are these immediate or delayed hypersensitivity reaction? Now look at this picture. Now this picture shows us the type 4 or delayed hypersensitivity response. Now I want you to please have a look, or please understand carefully. Now what happens whenever a person is exposed to any endogen or exogenous antigen, these antigens are taken up by the first defense cell, which is called as antigen presenting cell. Now this antigen presenting cell, they process that antigen and they display it over its surface. Now these antigen presenting cell, it goes and it meets the T cells, which are naive T cells in the lymph node. Now these antigen presenting cell, then stimulate and forms the, they stimulate the T cell and hence causes their activation. Now these activated T cell then goes or enters the blood supply, and through the blood it goes into the skin and causes the immediate hypersensitivity response. Now what happens, few or a fraction of T activated T or the T helper lymphocyte, they are converted into the memory T cells, and these memory T cells remain in the circulation. Now on subsequent stimulation, that is after, suppose a patient who is already sensitized, and if the patient is exposed to the same antigen after some time, now what happens, those memory cells or memory T cells which are already present, they will stimulate with the help of these antigen, and they will quickly form the Th1 type of cells, and these Th1 cell then causes the release of the cytokines which is responsible for the destruction. Now look at this picture. This is the antigen presenting cell. So this is a case of already sensitized individual. So this antigen presenting cells, it is having this antigen or exogenous or endogenous antigen. Now they are taking this antigen to the T cells. Now here the T cells are not naive T cells. They are already immune or already sensitized T cells. So say they are memory T cells. Now these memory T cells, as they are already sensitized, they will quickly convert into the activated T lymphocytes. So these activated T lymphocytes, they are of mainly Th1 type. Now this Th1 lymphocyte, it will then secrete few cytokines. The most important cytokines is the TNF-alpha, the interferon gamma, and the IL-2. And these three cytokines are then responsible for the localized reaction which occurs at the site of the dermal intradermal injection. So am I clear to all of you? Vasavi, Shubham, Sunny, Monica, what exactly happens in the case of the type 4 hypersensitivity reaction? Please give me a thumbs up if I am clear. This is the basic, and then further we will discuss about the causes or the types. So I'm clear to all of you. What is the exact pathogenesis of formation of type 4 hypersensitivity reaction? Okay, now starting with the first intradermal test, which is very important, that is the tuberculin test. Tuberculin test is also called as Perquet test. So you may get in exam the question saying that the Perquet test is. So this is another name for the tuberculin test. Now here the antigen used are the tuberculin antigen, which is purified protein extract of the bacilli which are grown at the 5% of glycerol growth. So here there is only, there is nothing to explain. We just use the purified protein extract of the bacilli which are artificially grown in the lab with the help of 5% glycerol. And this tuberculin is then injected intradermally on the flexural aspect of the forearm, and the reading is taken after 48 hours. So can you have a look up over this picture? So we are injecting over the flexural surface of the forearm, and then we have to mark this area, and we will visualize this area after 48 hours. Now after 48 hours, we have to measure the induration. It is very important. There are two or three type of reaction. The first is erythema formation, second is edema formation, and third is induration. So the point which is important for us is the size of the induration or the diameter of the induration. When the diameter of induration is less than 5 mm, then we can say that the tuberculin test is negative. When it is 6 to 9 mm, it means the test is doubtful. In these cases, we have to use some alternative method for the diagnosis of tuberculosis. It can be quantiferon gold test or it can be skin biopsy. Now, if the diameter of induration is 10 to 15 mm, it means the test is positive. Now this test can be positive in two conditions. It can be because of infection with M. tuberculosis, and it can also occur secondary to vaccination. So we know that everybody is vaccinated against the tuberculosis. So this type of positive reaction can be seen in both of these conditions. But if the size of the induration is more than 15 mm, it means it is only because of the infection with M. tuberculosis. It never occurs secondary to the vaccination against the tuberculosis. So this is very important to label it as the infection, then it should be more than 15. And again, if it is 10 to 15, then we have to use some other method to diagnose, that is the biopsy or the quantiferon gold test. So I think I'm clear with this test. Now coming to the second test, that is lepromin skin test. This is also an intradermal test, and this is done in case of Mycobacterium leprae infection, that is in Hansen's disease. Now, this is only a hypersensitivity reaction. We cannot use this test for making the diagnosis. Now, why is it so? Why we are not able to make the diagnosis? Because in case of Mycobacterium leprae, we know that the disease is manifest in varied number of clinical presentation. And these varied number of clinical presentation depends upon the immune status of the individual. We have seen that at the lepromatous pole, the immunity or the cell-mediated immune response is very low, or in some cases it is almost absent. So we know that intradermal test occurs secondary to cell-mediated immunity or type 4 hypersensitivity reaction. So this type of reaction is not seen in case of lepromatous leprosy. So we will not able to identify the cases of lepromatous leprosy with the help of lepromin skin test. And hence, this is not a diagnostic test. It is just a test which is used for prognosis of the patient or following this patient subsequently after the treatment. Now, the antigen, which is lepromin, it is prepared by two methods. First is Mistura lepromin, which is derived from armadillo, which is a 9-banded cold-blooded animal. And another is Dharmendra lepromin, which is derived from the human tissue. So if you have any doubts regarding this, you can ask me in between. Otherwise, I'll continue. Okay. So Monica, Sunny, Shubham, Vasavi, if you have any doubts, just let me know. Now, the intradermal injection in case of lepromin test, it involves two type of responses. The first or the early response is called as Fernandez response. Now, this response occurs within 48 hours of injection. Now, what is the reason for Fernandez test? The reason is the delayed hypersensitivity or the type 4 hypersensitivity response against the bacillary antigen, which is the normal phenomena in all the intradermal test. While there is one more type of response, that is a delayed response seen in case of lepromin test. Now, this is called as Mistura. It occurs after 4 weeks. And this response is because of the generation of the cell-mediated immune response against the lepra bacilli. So this is very important. The Fernandez test is because of delayed hypersensitivity to bacillary antigen, while the early is because of the delayed hypersensitivity, and the delayed reaction is because of the formation of CMI against the lepra bacilli. Now, few of the questions I want you to solve. This is very important. You'll get an idea that how they can ask you questions from these intradermal tests. So please answer this question. So here we use lepromin test, Arun. If you are asking for the lepra reaction, we use lepromin as an antigen, which is of two type. One which is derived from armadillo and another one which is derived from the human cells or the infected human body. So there are two type of antigens. So I want you to answer this question. Monica, Sunny, Shubham, Vaishnavi, Arun. A 16-year-old student reported for the evaluation of multiple hypopigmented macules on the trunk and the limbs. All of the following tests are useful in making the diagnosis of leprosy except. Yes, the answer of the question is number 2, because we have just now discussed that lepromin test is not a diagnostic test. It is only used for prognosis or the follow-up of the management. So this is very important, Monica. I think now you are clear with the question. So the answer here is option number 2. Now, positive in which type of leprosy? So if you are not able to answer this question, don't worry, because I will teach you everything in my topic on leprosy. Those who are subscribed on an academy, they can access my classes, the plus classes. I've already taken classes on leprosy. So I think after going through my classes on leprosy, these questions will be very easy for you. So what is the answer to this? Yes, so Monica, you are right. Arun, you are also right. The answer to this question is option number 4, that is tuberculoid. So as I've discussed that in leprosy, we have two poles. The first is the tuberculoid pole and another is the lepromatous pole. The cell-mediated immunity is strongest at the tuberculoid pole, while it is the poorest or absent against the lepromatous pole. And lepromin test depends upon the immune status of the individual. So it is present in only tuberculoid pole. So I think all of you are right. Now, coming to the third important intradermal test, that is the Frye's test. See, these tests are important because they can give you match the following questions, or they can give you they can ask you that Frye's test is seen in which type of diseases. So you should at least know the name. The Frye's test is seen in lymphogranuloma venereum. This is one of the cause of sexually transmitted disease. It mainly presents with inguinal lymph node enlargement, which is called as bubo. Now, how does this test is performed? we take the antigen from the pus of the unruptured bubo. We dilute this pus with saline and we sterilize it by heating. So this antigen is prepared. Now what we do, we inject the 0.1 ml of the prepared antigen onto the volar aspect of the forearm. So can you appreciate, we are injecting the antigen into the intradermal space at the volar or the flexural area of the forearm. We will also inject a control, that is similar amount of yolk sac or diluent on the opposite hand, so that it will act as a control. The reading is done after 48 hours. And we will find that a 6 mm of papule, if there is in presence of 6 mm papule, which is present here, it means that the reaction is positive and it means that the patient has antibodies or the sensitization to the lymphogranuloma venereum infection. The control, the size of the papule at the control should be less than 5. If the size over the control area is also more than 6, it means that it is just a hypersensitivity reaction to the prick. It is not because of the LGV infection. So I think I'm clear to all of you. So that is the reason why we have injected the control, so that we will make sure that it is because of the localized antigen. It is not because of the localized hypersensitivity reaction. Now, what are the disadvantages? The important disadvantages is the test will only become positive after the appearance of bubo. It can take almost 8 to 80 days for the appearance of the bubo. So it is not an early test. Another is it can be positive in other infections which occurs because of the chlamydia of non-LGV serovar. For example, chlamydia trachomatis. We know that chlamydia trachomatis mainly causes the ophthalmic infection. But in these cases also, the Fry's test will become positive. So this is one of the disadvantages. Another disadvantage is the test will remain positive for many years after the clinical cure. So we will not tell us, this will not tell us about the acute infection. It can remain positive for many years even after the complete cure. So these are some of the disadvantages. Now coming to the fourth test, which is called as Itto-Reinsterna test. This is also very important. The Itto-Reinsterna test, it occurs in a patient with chancroid. Now what is chancroid? It is a genital disease or a sexually transmitted disease which is caused by Haemophilus Ducray. The classical clinical presentation of chancroid is presence of multiple painful genital ulcers which are non-indurated. So the ulcers of chancroid is also called as soft canker. Now this test, which is an intradermal test, now how it is done? We inject the vaccine containing the killed H. Ducray in the suspension. So we'll take the vaccine, we'll dilute it, and then the diluted antigen is taken and injected intradermally into the forearm of the patient. Now the results are noted after 48 days. So you can see the presence of inflammatory papule, that is of 0.5 to 1 mm, 1 centimeter in size. So here you can appreciate the presence of 0.5 to 1 centimeter of the diameter. So this is a positive reaction. This test is obsolete nowadays and it is not at all done. So that is why you can see that this is a very old picture which I could find. So this test is not done nowadays, but it is important for your exam point of view. You just need to know that the Itto-Reinsterna test is associated with chancroid infection. Now the fifth test is the Leishmanin test. The Leishmanin test, it is introduced by Montenegro in South America and hence it is also called as Montenegro reaction. Now this is also a delayed hypersensitivity reaction. Here the antigen used is the washed promastigote. Now what are these promastigote? Now this Leishmanin occurs in the leishmaniasis and leishmaniasis occurs because of a protozoa. Now the leishmaniasis causing protozoa, it remains in two forms. One is the promastigote form, which is the motile form, and another is amastigote form, which is amotile form. The amastigote form is the most common form which is present in the human body and it is mainly present inside the macrophages. So it is the intracellular bodies. While the promastigote, it mainly remains in the blood of the vector as well as the human. So these promastigotes, the flagellate or the motile form, they are washed in 10 ml of suspended 5% phenol saline. And it is the 0.1 ml of this is used as a test dose. Now after 48 to 72 hours, an induration of more than 5 mm is formed. So this is the positive test. So here you can see the presence of more than 0.5 mm of a papule or induration. So this is very classical of leishmaniasis. Now this test, there is few disadvantage. This test is negative in case of Kala Azar or disseminated cutaneous leishmaniasis. Now the reason here is same like that of leprosy. In leishmaniasis also, the clinical presentation are wide in variety. The clinical presentation depends upon the immune status of the individual. In few cases, the disease is limited to the only the skin surface or the mucosa, while in other individuals, it is present all over the body, that is disseminated. In those individuals where the immune status is low, it is mainly disseminated, while in case of in high immune status, it is localized. So the Kala Azar and the disseminated cutaneous leishmaniasis, it occurs in the patient with low cell mediated immunity, and hence there is negative lepromin test, negative leishmanin test. So this is very important, and you should know the difference that it is positive in which type of leishmaniasis. Now this is what I was explaining you, that the promastigote forms, they are converted into the amastigote form, which are non-motile, and they are mainly present inside the macrophages. Now this the vector, that is the sand fly, it bites the infected individual, and the promastigote form enters into the body. It is converted into the amastigote form inside the body or the larynx of the sand fly, and on subsequent exposure or subsequent biting, there will be injection of these amastigote form into the another person. So this is the mode of transmission of leishmaniasis. Now there are two type of leishmaniasis, that is old world cutaneous leishmaniasis and new world cutaneous leishmaniasis. I will be explaining you in detail when I will be teaching you about the leishmaniasis in my classes. Just a brief that it is of two type. First is cutaneous leishmaniasis. Second is leishmaniasis recidivans, and the third is disseminated form. And the new world, it is also similar to that, cutaneous, and the disseminated, that is visceral and post-dermal Kala Azar. So I think you don't have to go much in detail here. You can have a look over this picture. This is the localized form of leishmaniasis, and this is the disseminated form, where you can see multiple nodules or papules over the back and over the face. So this is the classical presentation of the leishmaniasis. Coming to the sixth test, that is trichophyton test. Now this test is performed to detect the allergic hypersensitivity towards the dermatophyte, that is the superficial fungal infection. The antigen used here is the extracted spores of the dermatophyte named trichophyton mentagrophyte. So we know that there are three type of dermatophytic species: trichophyton, epidermophyton and microsporum. In trichophyton test, we use this trichophyton mentagrophyte as the antigen. We inject this intradermally, that is 0.1 ml of normal saline. We use 10 microgram in 0.1 ml, and then we inject it on the flexural aspect. The reading is taken after 20 minutes, that is immediate reaction, and after 24 to 72 hours, that is the delayed reaction. Here you can see this type of responses, that is presence of veal. The veal of larger than 10 mm, it is positive, while at 72 hours, a veal of more than 0.5 mm is positive. So here you can see a picture where we have done intradermal test in the intradermal test against various fungal species. And you can see positive reaction to some of them. So this is just a simple intradermal test to the fungal infection. Coming to the next, so these were the intradermal tests which were done in the infective condition. Now we are coming to non-infective condition. The most common condition here is the pathergy test. Now what is this pathergy test? It is an intradermal test which is used in the diagnosis of a disease which is called as Behçet's disease. Behçet's disease is a very important disease. Here we tend to see oral and genital ulcers. We can see the changes over the eye, that is conjunctivitis. And we can also see the changes over the skin. So this is a multi-system disorder, that is the Behçet's disease. Now how does this pathergy test is done? In pathergy test, we inject 0.1 ml of isotonic salt, that is normal saline 0.1 ml, with the help of 20 gauge needle. The technique is very important. So can you have a look over this picture? So this is the epidermis, this is the dermis, this is the forearm of the patient. We have to inject the needle at an angle of 30 degree to the surface of the skin. And the beveled edge should be facing upward. So can you see the beveled edge? It is facing upward. So the technique should be this. Now, if we inject, we have to inject the syringe only 3 to 5 mm deep. We don't have to go much deep. So it should be at the level of 30 degree from the surface and only 3 to 5 mm deep. So I think I'm clear with the technique of pathology test. Now what is seen that after 24 to 48 hours, we tend to see a erythematous papule of more than 2 mm at the site of prick. So can you appreciate this 2 mm or more than 2 mm erythematous papule? So this is a positive test in case of pathology or in case of Behçet's. Now as discussed, the Behçet's disease is a disease which consists of oral lesions, genital lesions, ocular lesions and cutaneous lesions. Here the classical lesions which are present in the genitalia, these are aphtha-like reaction. So you can see aphthas-like ulcers which is present over the genital area. Here also there is aphthas-like lesion which is present over the oral mucosa. And here you can appreciate there is eyelid changes, that is there is eyelid ptosis, can be follicular lesions, pyodermic lesions. There can be CNS features also, there can be increased in the pressure of the CNS blood. So these are some of the cutaneous as well as systemic manifestation of Behçet's disease. And the pathology test is one of the diagnostic criteria for diagnosing the Behçet's disease. The basis of pathology test is almost the same. It is the same, that is the delayed hypersensitivity test. That was I was trying to tell you, Monica, that all the intradermal tests, they have the same basis. The basis is the delayed hypersensitivity response or stimulation in a pre-sensitized individual. Okay. Now the Kevaim test. Now Kevaim test is done in case of sarcoidosis. It is also a diagnostic test in case of sarcoidosis. Now what is the test used for? The test can be utilized to differentiate from the other causes of diffuse pulmonary mottling. We know that the classical presentation of the sarcoid is involvement of lung as well as eye as well as the skin manifestation. But these three type of manifestation can be seen in large variety of diseases. So to differentiate the sarcoidosis from the other diseases, we do this Kevaim test. Now here the antigen used is prepared from the splenic tissue of the dead or the autopsy of a patient who has died with sarcoidosis. So the splenic tissue is obtained and then we will dilute this splenic tissue prepared and we will inject it into the intraepidermal space prepared. And you can see presence of this type of the lesion. You can see the development of nodules also. Usually it takes almost 4 to 6 weeks or almost 1 to 1.5 months for formation of this nodule. Now only the formation of nodule is not diagnostic. We have to take the biopsy from this nodule. If the biopsy shows the characteristic presentation of the sarcoidosis, that only means that we are dealing with sarcoidosis. So this is one of the important diagnostic relevance to the diagnosis of sarcoidosis. Okay. Coming to the next one, that is autologous serum testing, or this is also called as ASST. Now it is seen that in about 25 to 45% patients of chronic idiopathic urticaria, they have autoantibodies which are directed against the IgE antibodies, that is the Fc fragment of the IgE antibodies. Now these antibodies, if present in the serum, can cause the wheeling and the erythema. So we think that we know that in almost 25 to 45% of the patient of chronic idiopathic urticaria, they have autoantibodies formed against the Fc fragment of the IgE. Now when if these antibodies are present, they can easily be diagnosed with the help of intradermal test. So this is the basis for the ASST, that is autologous serum skin testing. Now here what we do, first we prepare the ASST. Now how this ASST is prepared? We take 8 ml of the blood of the patient and then we centrifuge this blood. We centrifuge it at the 1200 RPM for almost 8 minutes. Now after doing the centrifugation, there is separation non-cellular part. And the red blood cell and the white blood cell, they mainly remains at the lower part, whereas the platelet as well as the serum and the plasma remains at the upper part. So this upper part is used for doing the test. We will inject 0.5 ml of the patient's own serum, that is the upper part which is made after the centrifugation, and we will also inject saline on the other hand for the control. Now if the wheal of more than 1.5 mm is present, it means that the patient has antibody against the IgE which is present. So this is a very important test done in case of chronic urticaria. In these cases, if AST is given regularly intramuscularly, then it can also act as a treatment. So I think I'm clear to you. This is a little bit difficult. If you are not getting the procedure, you should just know that these are some of the intradermal tests. Okay. The cases of idiopathic urticaria were designated as autoimmune urticaria. So this is also a very important thing. Now coming to the last test, that is histamine test. Now histamine test, it is done in cases of leprosy. Now what is histamine test? In histamine test, we inject the histamine intradermally. Now after injection of histamine, there is a bright red histamine flare. This occurs because of capillary vasodilatation. Now do you know about the triple response of Leves? The triple response of Leves have 3 points. The first is because of injection or release of histamine, there is sudden vasodilatation which causes erythema to the localized site. Now because of this vasodilatation, there is the fluid comes out of the vessels and it forms edema. So this is the second phase. Now the third phase is because of the axonal reflex, there is a rebound erythema which occurs in the surrounding skin, and this axonal reflex is because of the peripheral nervous system. So in leprosy, these nerves are affected. So on injecting the histamine, there is no axonal reflex, so the surrounding erythema is not seen. It is only the first two step of Leves which is present in case of leprosy. So thus we can see that the histamine can be used to test the integrity of the dermal nerves in case of the tuberculoid leprosy. So am I clear to all of you? What is the histamine test, how it is done, and for what condition it is done? You want me to explain it again, or I think you clearly understood? So instead of the three response of Leves, only two response occur. That is the first, which is the erythema at the site of stroking, and the second, that is edema at the site of stroking. The third response, that is the peripheral erythema which occurs because of the zonal reaction, is not there. This is because of the absence of the dermal nerves in case of leprosy. Now, how this test is done? We inject one drop of histamine. This is the drop of histamine which is placed on the skin. And now through this drop, we will make a superficial prick. Now like this, so this is a drop and we are making a superficial prick. And this superficial prick is made through the drop. And immediately we can see the bright red flare which appears within a minute of the dermal nerve involvement if it is intact. So I think it is clear. Yes, Monica, it is useful for leprosy. In leprosy patient, to check whether the dermal nerves are intact or not, we use this type of histamine test. And we know that in leprosy, the dermal nerves are usually not intact, so they will not respond to this histamine test. There will be no peripheral flaring. Only first two step of Leves will occur. The last, that is the axonal reflex, will not occur. So this is done for leprosy. In lepromatous leprosy, also in the late stages when there is involvement of the nerves, I have told you in my class that in lepromatous leprosy, the involvement of the nerve is at a later part. It do not occur at the earlier stage of the disease. So in the later stage, when the nerves are get involved, then we can see this type of histamine test. But mainly it is done for tuberculoid leprosy only, because in tuberculoid leprosy, the damage to the nerve occur at the initial stage. So I think I'm done for today's class. So I know today's class was boring, but the test, the name is very important. So I want you to just go back and write on a paper the name of the intradermal test and in the diseases which is seen. So it is important. You may get the match the following type of questions. You may get questions like it is seen in what all diseases or not. See, Monica have asked me which is better, lepromin or histamine test. So Monica, you cannot compare lepromin test. We are checking the localized cell mediated immune response. While in case of histamine test, we are checking the integrity of the dermal nerves. So we cannot compare between the lepromin test and histamine test. The basis of both the reactions are completely different to you. So one more notice again I want to make those who have joined late. So we are going with a crash course in dermatology, where we are dealing with high yield topic for the FMGE as well as for NEET. Here in this course, there is a class at 7:30 daily. The course have already started from 16th May, and the course will go up to the 4th. Subscribe to Unacademy. I request you to just go and subscribe. You can use No, Monica, there is no risk of development of disease because of this intradermal test, because it strains of the organism. So for especially like in case of Mycobacterium leprae, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we use the attenuated strains, or we can say that non-infectious strains we are using. So we will not get any type of disease with these intradermal test. Okay, this is just for the response against these antigen, which is noted. So I think I'm done with today's class. So we'll meet again at 7:30. The today's topic is the basics in dermatology and the appendageal structures of dermatology. So I want you to please attend my class at 7:30 p.m. also. So good night and stay at home, stay safe. So bye bye.